Hello and welcome to our service today, where we celebrate the third Sunday of Epiphany, but also the end of the week of prayer for Christian unity, a time when we celebrate with our ecumenical partners around the world. The theme for this week has been Abide in Christ, and how we think about abiding in Christ's love and how he provides for us in abundance, which is reflected in our readings today and in the sermon by Bishop Michael. And hope you will enjoy the service as we start with our first hymn.
You form the earth and mountains high. You bless us with this gift of life. Every little leaf we have, your grace supplies. So freely you've given your life.
Service for today. Grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and also with you. We say together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, have mercy. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So in a moment of silence, we bring our wrongdoings before God. And then let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May Almighty God have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so as God's forgiven people, we say the words of the Gloria together. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And so we pray the collect for the third Sunday of Epiphany. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your mighty power, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So I hand over now to Gareth and Debbie for our readings.
Our first reading today is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 19, verses 6 to 10. Then I heard what seemed to be a voice of a great multitude, like the sound of many waters, and like the sound of a mighty thunder peals, crying out, Alleluia, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. To her be granted to be clothed with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, Write this, Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, These are true words of God. Then I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, You must not do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and your comrades, who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, They have no wine. And Jesus said to her, Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, Do whatever he tells you. Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, Fill the jars with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward. So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now. Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
And so I'd like to welcome Bishop Michael, who has our sermon for the day.
Are you keeping dry January this month? I'm not, but I know many people who are, and it is an important public health opportunity, giving up alcohol for a while after the indulgence of Christmas. And this year it can be particularly helpful for us to attend to our drinking in these days of lockdown. But if you are trying to keep dry January, then I should think that this morning's gospel must be quite a challenge, because it shows Jesus doing something very, very different. At the wedding in Cana of Galilee, Jesus produces a huge amount of wine out of water. Just do the maths. There are six stone jars, each holding between 20 or 30 gallons. And they are filled to the brim with water. Even if each jar only holds 20 gallons, that means 120 gallons in total. That's 545 litres of wine. Now, a standard bottle of wine today contains 75 centilitres. So Jesus has produced the equivalent of 727 bottles of wine for a party which has already drunk its way through the cellar. And if you take the higher figure of 30 gallons for the stone water jars, then the stock taking rises to, I think, 1,090 bottles. If you've been enjoying yourself at that wedding in Cana of Galilee, you probably would have had a very, very sore head next morning. It's a lot of wine. What is the gospel trying to tell us? Well, it's not really about drinking alcohol or abstaining from alcohol. It is, as John says, a sign of abundance, a sign of superabundance. Because it says that our God is a God of excessive generosity, exuberant in the kindness he lavishes upon us. This is his nature. This is how he is. This is who he is. And that theme of abundance runs through the whole New Testament. The sower in the parable scatters the grain everywhere, and most of it is lost. But what falls on the good soil produces amazing yields, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. In another parable, the workers recruited to the vineyard in the last hour are paid with the same generosity as others who have slaved throughout the heat and toil of the day, to the bewilderment of everybody. St. Paul says that the love of God is shed abroad by the Holy Spirit into the hearts of the ungodly, and in their justification, the justice of God bears the fruits of amazing grace. Christian faith speaks of undeserved, unexpected, unscientific abundance. And this is the sign that Jesus sets before us at Cana of Galilee. So this wedding at Cana is a story of great quantity, but it's also a story of high quality. The wine that Jesus produces is wine of the very best. There is a man at this wedding called the steward of the feast. I guess that nowadays we call him the event organizer. He's the person who's meant to be in charge to make sure that all the plans go right. And this man is surprised that the Lord has kept the best wine till last. Interesting, by the way, to know that one early writer on this gospel passage says that the steward is the only person whose judgment about the wine we can trust. Why can we trust him? Well, because he's had to organise the party, so he's the only person there who's had to remain sober. Be that as it may, the best wine is kept to the end. What Jesus gives is promised to us as the completion of our time, the perfection of our human nature, a fullness of life for which all our days on earth are a training and a preparation. John says that at Cana, Jesus revealed his glory. Glory, that's the word he uses for that fulfillment of what we are and what we are meant to be. The glorious quality of the life to which Jesus calls you and me cannot be beaten for quality. So we've got quantity and we've got quality. And of course, any sermon needs 3 points, and it would be really helpful if I could think of a third point beginning with Q. So with some apologies, here's the word quaffability. Quantity, quality, quaffability. And by quaffability, I mean the urge to drink more and more of this wine. Of course, for an alcoholic, that kind of urge is a problem. But the water become wine that Jesus gives us is such that we want to return to it again and again, because it changes us from glory to glory, drawing us ever closer to the God whose nature is love. And the quaffability of this wine changes people's lives as they grow in their relationship with God. The tradition of the Eastern Orthodox Church says that at the wedding at Cana of Galilee, the bridegroom was in fact Simon the Zealot, one of the 12 apostles. And indeed it says that it was precisely because of what he experienced at Cana that Simon became one of the 12 apostles chosen by Jesus, because his life had been so transformed by what he had experienced there. And then actually other traditions go on to say that Simon the Zealot went on to preach the gospel in Africa and in Asia, and some say even in Britain. And traditions say that he met a martyr's death, maybe in Persia, or some traditions say maybe somewhere near Grimsby. Well, that may or may not be the case with Simon, but we don't have to be one of the 12 original apostles to want to drink again and again the wine of the kingdom which Jesus gives us, and to have our lives changed as we do that. At the moment, of course, in most of our churches, we are not gathering physically for the Eucharist. And when we can do that again, it will still be a long time, I imagine, before we can again share in the one common cup of wine. But that experience that we're in now, and the opportunity of spiritual communion that we can make online, these things should make us think more deeply about that great sacramental gift which most of the time we can enjoy and which much of the time we take for granted. Because the early Christians saw in this miracle at Cana a pointer to the wonder of Holy Communion. One of them, St. Cyril of Jerusalem, wrote this: "Once at Cana in Galilee, the Lord changed water into wine by his own will. Is it incredible that he should change wine into blood?" This quaffable wine of Cana draws us closer and closer to our generous God. Its quality speaks to us of the unimaginable glory to which we are called, you and I. And its sheer quantity proclaims the vastness of God's love poured out for us. And what was miraculously provided as a one-off for a group of invited guests in one town in Galilee, that gift is now given to us all in God's grace, freely lavished upon us here in Staffordshire and Shropshire and the Black Country. Even in these times of restriction and anxiety, perhaps particularly in these times of restriction and anxiety, God in Christ renews for us the wonder of Cana in Galilee. He gives us the abundant wine of hope to drink again and again.
Now, are you like me and thinking, wow, 1,000 bottles of wine, that would be nice in this lockdown? But as Bishop Michael said at the end there, it's not wine that we can pour out and get drunk on. It's wine that fills us with love and hope. It's God's abundant love for us. And how wonderful is that? Much better than 1,000 bottles of wine, I'm sure. Anyway, we're going to declare our faith now in that amazing, abundant God. So let's say together the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So I hand over now to Chris for our intercessions.
Drawn here by God, let us bring to him our concerns for the church and the world. At the end of the week of prayer for Christian unity, we are called by God. You did not choose me, but I chose you. One day you understood that without my being aware of it, a yes had already been inscribed in your innermost depths. And so you chose to go forward in the footsteps of Christ. A silence in the presence of Christ, you heard him say, "Come, follow me. I will give you a place to rest your heart." Jesus Christ, you seek us. You wish to offer us your friendship and lead us to a life that is ever more complete. Grant us the confidence to answer your call so that we may be transformed and become witnesses of your tenderness for the world. We are maturing internally. Abide in me as I abide in you. Without our knowing how, the Spirit makes Christ dwell in our hearts, and it is through prayer, by listening to the Word, in sharing with others, by putting into practice what we have understood, that the inner being is strengthened. Holy Spirit, may we receive in our hearts the presence of Christ and cherish it as a secret of love. Nourish our prayer, enlighten our reading of Scripture, act through us, so that the fruits of your gifts can patiently grow in us. We are forming one body. Love one another as I have loved you. Jesus wishes that life and love circulate through us as the sap through the vine, so that Christian communities be one body. But today, as in the past, it is not easy to live together. We are often faced with our own limitations. At times we fail to love those who are close to us, in our community, parish, or family. There are times when our relationships break down completely. God our Father, you reveal to us your love through Christ and through our brothers and sisters. Open our hearts so that we can welcome each other with our differences and live in forgiveness. Grant us to live united in one body, so that the gift that is each person comes to light. May all of us together be a reflection of the living Christ. We are praying together. Getting together in a group offers us support. Through hymns, words and silence, communion is created. If we pray with Christians of other traditions, we may be surprised to feel united by a bond of friendship that comes from the one who is beyond all division. The forms may vary, but it is the same Spirit that brings us together. Lord Jesus, your entire life was prayer, perfect harmony with the Father. Through your Spirit, teach us to pray according to your will of love. May the faithful of the whole world unite in intercession and praise, and may your kingdom of love come. Let yourself be transformed by the Word. The Word of God is very close to us. It is a blessing and a promise of happiness. If we open our hearts, God speaks to us and patiently transforms us. He removes that which prevents the growth of real life, just as the vine grower prunes the vine. We are constantly called to renew our commitment to life through our thoughts and actions. There are times when we already taste, here and now, the blessing that will be fulfilled at the end of time. Blessed are you, God our Father, for the gift of your word in Holy Scripture. Blessed are you for its transforming power. Help us choose life and guide us with your Spirit, so that we can experience the happiness which you want so much to share with us. God asks that we welcome others. Go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. When we let ourselves be transformed by Christ, his love in us grows and bears fruit. Welcoming the other is a concrete way of sharing the love that is with us. Jesus Christ, we desire to welcome fully the brothers and sisters who are with us. You know how often we feel helpless in the face of their suffering, yet you are always there ahead of us, and you have already received them in your compassion. Speak to them through our words, support them through our actions, and let your blessing rest on us all. We grow in unity. I am the vine, you are the branches. Christ's will commits us to a path of unity and reconciliation. It also commits us to unite our prayer to his, that they may all be one, so that the world may believe. Holy Spirit, vivifying fire and gentle breath, come and abide in us, renew in us the passion for unity, so that we may live in awareness of the bond that unites us in you. May all who have put on Christ at their baptism unite and bear witness together to the hope that sustains them. Reconciling with all of creation, so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. The newness of life that Christ brings, however hidden, is a light of hope for many. It is a wellspring of reconciliation for the whole of creation and contains a joy that comes from beyond ourselves, so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. Do you wish to celebrate the newness of life that Christ gives through the Holy Spirit? And let it live in you, among us, in the church, in the world, and in all of creation. Thrice holy God, we thank you for having created and loved us. We thank you for your presence in us and in creation. May we learn to look upon the world as you look upon it with love. In the hope of this vision, may we be able to work for a world where justice and peace flourish, for the glory of your name. Amen.
Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey, we're companions on the road. We are here to help each other walk a mile and bear the load.
I will hold the Christ light for you in the night time of your fear. I will hold my hand out to you, speak a peace you long to hear. I
will weep when you are weeping. When you laugh, I'll laugh with you. I will share your joy and sorrow till we've seen this journey through. When we sing to God, such harmony, for of all we've known together of Christ's love and agony. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too.
And so we come to our time of spiritual communion. And now we give you thanks because you formed your church on the apostles to stand firm forever as a sign on earth of your infinite holiness and the living gospel for all to hear. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in the grave, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. Jesus says, listen, I'm standing at the door, knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come into you and eat with you, and you with me. Lord our God, you prepare a table before us, and although we cannot be present at your Holy Eucharist, by your grace, open our hearts to receive the gift of your Son, the Word made flesh, who on the night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. So send your Holy Spirit upon us, that, though separated by distance, we may still, through faith, be partakers in the benefits of Christ's offering, of his body and his blood. This we ask through the same Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. And we say together, most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. And so now we're going to have a time of our own spiritual communion with God, where we listen and hear for his word. The spiritual communion will conclude by the saying of the Lord's Prayer. So, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The Lord says, remember, I am with you to the end of the age. And so we come now to a time of our notices. So I hand over to Debbie for our ETB news.
And so we come to our notices for this week. The first notice is to say that the Lifting the Lid course, which has been fantastic, is drawing to an end, and we plan on running the Resolve course in its place. This focuses on body, mind and soul, and it runs for 3 weeks from the 1st of February at 11 a.m. on Zoom. So if you'd want to explore well-being for body, mind and soul, then please do give me a call, drop me an email, or phone Lisa, or drop Lisa an email, and we'll make sure that you get the links to join us for that course. We continue our knitting for the Baby Bank. And if you want some more information on the Baby Bank and all that it does, then please do see the video that's on the electronic newsletter this week. That will give you lots more information. But we are knitting hats, gloves, mittens, scarves, cardigans and jumpers for the under fours at the moment. And any of those can be dropped off at the rectory or dropped off with Kerry at Rockwood Ironwood Church between 9 and 11, Monday to Friday, or dropped with Sue Rawlins, who is our link for the Baby Bank. We're back to our quizzes, and our quiz for January is raising funds for Rockwood Ironwood Church. in rotation. We do a church each month, and this quiz will be on the 31st of January at 6 o'clock, again on Zoom. Really easy to join us on Zoom. You just have to click on a link, you appear on the screen, and it is lots and lots of fun. So if you do want to join us for that quiz, if you can contact me, Kerry, or Tanya, and we will make sure that you are added onto those groups. If you have started to join us via the World Wide Web for the first time, then you have the opportunity to join what's known as our church electoral rolls. That basically says that you're a member of our church and that you join us for services online or in person or both. If you're not a member of the electoral roll and you would like to be, if you would like to contact me, then I'll make sure that I can get the paperwork to you. It gives you a vote in APCMs, and it gives you a sense of being part of something in a more formalised manner. You also get included on our statistics of returns, etc, etc. But please do, if you want to be part of our electoral roll, do let me know, and I will put you in touch with the electoral roll officers of the churches that is appropriate for you. And then finally this week, just please again, another request for you to pray for those who are in pain, who are grieving, within our parishes and within the wider world. And if you could particularly keep in your prayers the families of those who will be having funerals in our parishes in the coming days and weeks. And they are the families of Brenda Waugh, Joe Asplin, Phyllis Dolphin and Gary Jones. It's been great to be with you again this week. It's been great to share worship with you. And we will see you again soon. God bless, wherever you are.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed our service today. It's been great to be with you, and I look forward to being with you again soon. But before we go, I'd like to pray God's blessing upon you all. Christ, the Son of God, perfect in you the image of his glory, and gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Do go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Do enjoy our hymns after this service.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing.
10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Your holy name, worship your holy name.